Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger. Today I want to have a little informal discussion with you about directions in geometry, in modern geometry, especially with regard to the difference between a synthetic approach to geometry and an analytic approach to geometry. These are sort of two interesting different directions, both historically very valuable and important, but if you're an amateur mathematician, perhaps interested in doing some geometrical investigations, I think it's useful to have an orientation towards them. And I'm going to try to convince you that actually the analytic approach is probably more useful to you. And I'm going to give you 10 reasons why that is, all right? So first of all, we have to discuss, what does this mean? What are these terms referring to? So very roughly speaking, a synthetic approach to geometry has its origins, in the work of the ancient Greeks. Euclid elements had constructions very prominently in the first few books. And so this idea of proving geometrical theorems by making constructions and having a good idea of what kinds of constructions are allowed and how to make them and what properties they have, that's the synthetic approach. Now, the analytic approach, very roughly, has its origins in the French mathematicians Descartes and Fermat, with the introduction of coordinates, a coordinate framework where we try to specify points with coordinates and lines with coordinates and everything sort of with coordinates and try to work things out using algebra. Now, an important feature of that that Descartes himself impressed upon us was that there was a certain flexibility here, that you have a particular geometrical situation. And if you're going to apply an analytic approach, your first step is to sort of try to figure out what's the most optimal coordinate system to impose on this. So it's not always the case that we just work with our standard Cartesian coordinates x and y. Descartes realized that there were certain situations where you should be more flexible as to which coordinate systems you're going to be using. And that's actually going to be really important for us as we move towards understanding the Hexagrammum Mysticum, right, which is our sort of aim in this series. So there's going to be all kinds of really interesting things, but we want to have a sort of a good foundation for doing that. So what are some arguments that are in favor of the analytic approach vis-a-vis the synthetic approach? Well, perhaps the first one is that the analytic approach can be more easily modeled and checked on a computer. Computers are excellent at doing algebra. They are not so good at coming up with constructions of a synthetic kind. And so if you're going to be using computers a lot, that's a really good reason for adopting a basic analytic framework. A second reason is that implicit hidden assumptions are something that we always have to worry about when we're doing geometry, especially in a synthetic context, because sometimes the constructions that you're doing depend on having a diagram. Okay, in fact, that's usually how constructions work. You have a diagram and you're actually making these physical constructions on the page. And then it turns out that maybe the configuration that you're starting with has some particular properties that will make the constructions do something or not do something. So that the result might be a little bit dependent on the actual configuration that you start with. When you adopt an algebraic point of view, you're perhaps a little bit less likely to get involved in that kind of difficulty. The third reason is that purely algebraic arguments tend to be more likely generalizable. And by that we mean that they're likely to extend to more general fields. Usually we're doing geometry over an underlying number system, typically the rational numbers, but these days also finite fields are increasingly important. And so it's nice to have an approach that will bridge the gap between various fields so that we don't have to be overly concerned with the nature of the underlying field. And it's especially attractive if we can step away from all these assumptions that the so-called real number field magically is supposed to have, okay? So we want to be less reliant on those dubious aspects of the real numbers and have rather an approach that is so general that it will work for general fields. That's a very attractive aim to have, okay? It's something that we should strive to. Related to that is something a little bit more subtle in that when we're doing metrical geometry, typically involving a quadratic form, say on a vector space or an affine space or even a projective space. Quadratic form is typically given by a matrix, a symmetric matrix. And it's nice to have a theory that also allows you to move the quadratic form around, to not be stuck to, say, just the Euclidean quadratic form. So to have some flexibility in terms of the field, the underlying field that you're working over, and to have some flexibility as to the metrical structure that you're working with is very attractive. So for example, we might aim to do geometry, not just in the Euclidean context with, you know, x squared plus y squared kind of quadratic form, but say a relativistic setting where you have an x squared minus y squared quadratic form. Okay, so having an approach that encompasses all of these things is really great, and the algebraic approach is more in keeping with that. Related to that, we come to our fourth point, is that number theoretical considerations are more clearly defined. So when you do constructions, for example, a standard construction is an angle bisector. Okay, you have two lines that meet, and we say, now construct an angle bisector. But actually, if you have two lines that meet, actually there's, strictly speaking, sort of two angle bisectors, because the lines are like this, right? And you could sort of have an angle bisector in that direction. There's another angle bisector which is perpendicular. So in the situation where there's two of something, it's typical that there's actually an underlying quadratic equation that's involved. So implicit in the construction of an angle bisector is, from an algebraic point of view, the requirement that you have to find a square root of something. Okay? And when you have to find a square root of something, and you're doing it algebraically, you are dealing with a number theoretical situation. Right? That x squared equals alpha equation may have some solutions, in which case it has two of them, or it may have just one solution, or it may have zero solutions. And that depends on the field in which you're working, and it also depends on the alpha that you've got. So there's some number theory there, and when you're dealing with the algebraic approach, that becomes a lot clearer, okay? But just construction, say, well, make an angle bisector, it's not clear that there's actually some implicit number theory going on there. Fifth reason has to do with symmetry, okay? So symmetry is an important aspect of geometry, and symmetry and also anti-symmetry. These are often more clearly identifiable in an algebraic context because you may be facing some polynomial expression which is obviously sort of algebraically symmetrical in the variables that you're considering. Or maybe it's obviously anti-symmetric in the sense that if you interchange two things, maybe a minus sign is introduced. So a good example of that is if you have just a triangle in the affine plane, okay, there's actually two notions of area floating around. So there's a signed area, which is very important in the algebraic calculus, for those of you who have done the algebraic calculus. And that's basically given by a determinant. And that has the property that it's dependent on orientation. In other words, it has a kind of an anti-symmetry property. If you interchange two of the points in the order that you're going around the triangle, then the signed area will change sign. Now, if you're interested in a symmetrical version of area, you're sort of obliged to take the square of the signed area. Okay, so once you take the square of the signed area, then you remove that sensitivity to a change of sign, and you get something which is symmetric. Okay, so that's actually an important issue that comes up. And again, if you adopt an algebraic point of view, that sort of jumps out at you, because whether you've got, you know, this anti-symmetric expression or it's square is quite obvious. So you can see what you're dealing with a little more clearly in terms of symmetry. Our sixth reason for preferring an analytic approach over a synthetic approach is that less brilliance is often required. Okay? Synthetic arguments, especially complicated ones, have an imposing aspect. If you look at one of these, you know, classical proofs, there's all kinds of sort of brilliant things that are going on, like constructions which are highly non-obvious, and that only, you know, after some stages do you realize, oh, that was actually a really clever thing to do. I would never have thought of that, you might say. When you're working with an analytic approach, yes, you still have to think, and you still have to be careful, but maybe the reliance or the necessity of being really clever is reduced, and you're more focusing on being careful and setting things out well and sort of, you know, really having a good view of the entire landscape. And in fact, maybe the major amount of brain power has to occur at the initial stages when you're setting things up and deciding on what the coordinate system that you're going to use to begin with is. Okay, our seventh reason, which we've already talked about, is going back to Descartes, that in an analytic framework, you have this flexibility of choosing a coordinate system. So you have this really strong advantage that you can really dramatically simplify the situation by choosing a really appropriate coordinate system. We're going to be seeing this a lot as we talk about Pappus's theorem and then Pascal's Hexagrammum Mysticum situation. So this idea of choosing very carefully the original sort of coordinate framework, that going back to Descartes is a really positive advantage to the analytic point of view. Eight. Well, the analytic approach naturally meshes with rational trigonometry very nicely. So the power of rational trigonometry, which is very analytically based, I think can be more easily utilized with a general analytic approach. Nine, the formulas that we obtain are often sort of independent interest. So when we're working analytically, we have these various things. We're looking for establishing formulas for the quantities of interest. And often it's the case that if we do that in a nice way, the formulas that we obtain can be used in other situations. Once we have nice formulas for various constructions, then it's easy sort of to get them out of memory and to use them again in some slightly different context. So it's a case of sort of building a library, if you like, of useful formulas that capture various things of interest in a given situation. And our 10th reason for generally preferring an analytic orientation is that that's, I think, closer to the heart of modern linear algebra. And that's, perhaps sadly, as close as a lot of undergraduate students get to geometry. So, you know, their geometry is coming from doing a little bit of linear algebra in the geometrical context. Maybe they study some dot products and or some equations of conics or quadrics or something like this using some linear algebra. But in any case, this analytic approach does actually sort of sync with a general area of mathematics which is very important at the undergraduate level and that many students will be familiar with, much more so than they are actually familiar with, say, Euclid's Elements or more classical synthetic geometry. So we have perhaps a better chance of engaging the interest of young people by taking this point of view. Okay, so I hope these are some interesting thoughts, and we are going to be seeing, as we move towards understanding this fabulous Hexagrammum Mysticum, we're going to be seeing the power of trying to use an analytic approach to organize our investigations.